So I'll be discussing about echocardiographic assessment of hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. This is a brief overview of how I would like to cover this topic. I'll start with the evolution of imaging in hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, the definition, morphological types, briefly outline how to do an echo assessment, and what are the differential diagnosis, and what is the role of newer modalities in echocardiography, and with a final note on screening. So if you look at the evolution of imaging modalities for hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, it started in the 1960s with cardiac catheterization, LV angiography. This was the first thing available. By the late 1960s and 1970s, MO echocardiography became available. So then there was a description of the MO parameters like asymmetric hypertrophy and systolic anterior motion of the mitral valve. By 1980s, we had 2D echocardiography, where all these findings were further developed, and the MRI came about probably two decades back and has immensely contributed to the imaging of hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. So in the timeline of imaging, you find that initially HCM was described only on angiography and cardiac catheterization, and then it took around a decade for MO to come in, and we were able to describe features like SAM, LV thickness, LV dimensions. Then around another decade later came 2D Doppler, where we were able to differentiate different patterns, phenotypic patterns of HCM, mechanisms of LVOT obstruction. Doppler was able to give us gradients, and then transesophageal echo came in. And it took another almost 2.5 decades, where we stand today, for CMR to come in with high resolution of the imaging, which also gives us information on fibrosis and scarring. So currently where we stand today, CMR is the gold standard for the evaluation of HCM. Coming to the definition, hypertrophic cardiomyopathy is a primary genetic heart muscle disease characterized by hypertrophy of the left and or the right ventricle in the absence of significant ventricular dilatation, in the absence of systemic diseases like storage disease or amyloid, and in the absence of abnormal loading conditions. This is very important, like aortic valve diseases or systemic hypertension, anything else. Many times we may think the hypertrophy is due to HCM, but it may actually be due to an abnormal loading condition. So to summarize, it is an unexplained, isolated or inappropriate hypertrophy of the ventricular myocardium. Inappropriate because if the hypertrophy is out of proportion to the abnormal loading condition, for example, you have mild aortic stenosis but significant LVH, or mild hypertension with gross hypertrophy, that also is suggestive of HCM. Now, HCM is genetically divided into two types: the sarcomeric form, in which there are mutations of the cardiac sarcomeric proteins. This accounts for 40 to 50% of patients with HCM, and the non-sarcomeric mutations in multiple syndromes, as you can see on the left, like Danon disease, Fabry disease, Friedreich's ataxia, all these come into the non-sarcomeric forms of HCM, which account for another 5 to 10%. And in 25 to 30%, there is no genetic mutation identifiable. Now coming to the echocardiographic definition. So to make a diagnosis or presumptive diagnosis of HCM, you need to demonstrate hypertrophy of one or more segments of the left ventricular myocardium, which is measured in end diastole with a thickness of more than 15 millimeters in adults, more than or equal to 15 millimeters in adults. 12 to 15 millimeters is the range given for screening of asymptomatic relatives, and in children a z-score of more than 3 standard deviations for the age and the body surface area. So these are the basic criteria to detect the presence of LV hypertrophy. Now these measurements, I'll be coming to it later, should be done in MOD echocardiography, preferably in short axis views and at multiple levels of the myocardium. The hypertrophy in HCM is typically asymmetrical. Again, I'll be coming to this in the next few slides. The definition of asymmetrical hypertrophy is a septal to posterior wall thickness ratio of more than 1.3 in normotensive patients and 1.5 in hypertensive patients. So if you keep these basic measurements definition wise in mind, it will be easy to follow the next few slides. Coming to the echo assessment, the key steps in assessment are, first, to confirm the presence of hypertrophy, which is what I mentioned in the previous slide. to define the pattern and extent of hypertrophy, to assess whether or not there is LVOT obstruction, then evaluation of the mitral valve apparatus, assessment of LV, systolic and diastolic function, and then a few special things which we'll come to at the end. Now, as early as 1981, Marin et al. Have described different subsets, different types of hypertrophy in HCM. So it has been classified into 1, 2, 3 and 4 based on which part of the left ventricular myocardium is involved. Whether it's only the septum, the basal septum, entire septum, anterolateral wall or the apex. As recently as 2011, a similar classification was done by Helmi et al. Where they have classified it into septal hypertrophy alone, septum with adjacent segments excluding the apex. Type 3 is apical hypertrophy with other segments, and type 4 is pure isolated apical hypertrophy. Now when we look at the patterns of septal hypertrophy and hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, it has been described broadly into 4 types. The morphology of the septum is described into 4 types. So you have, don't have a pointer, but I'll use. Okay, if you look at panel A, it is called a neutral septum. That is, the septum is, yeah, I'm trying that, it's not. Is it coming on the screen? No. Okay, no problem. Neutral or straight septum is a septum which is neither concave nor convex into the ventricular cavity. So it's a hypertrophied septum which is almost straight in shape. Thank you. So this is a straight septum. Then type B is a sigmoid septum, which is commonly seen in elderly patients where there is a basal septal bulge which bulges into the cavity and the LVOT, but the rest of the septum is concave. It's only the basal septum which is hypertrophied, but the remaining part of the septum is concave with respect to the cavity. This is a sigmoid septum. Then you have the reverse curvature septum, also called as a catenoid septum. Catenoid septum is a septum which is uniformly convex, that is, it bulges into the left ventricular cavity as opposed to the sigmoid septum. And then you have apical hypertrophy where the hypertrophy is confined to the apex. So these are the 4 types of septal hypertrophy. These are some echo images. So this is a catenoid septum which is bulging into the cavity. This is a neutral septum which is neither concave nor convex. Then you have a sigmoid septum which is commonly seen in older adults, and the apical hypertrophy. I'll show you some moving clips later on. Now what is the importance of this classification? It is found that the catenoid septum and neutral septum are the most common subtypes among the 4 types of septal hypertrophy. These 2 are the most common, and these 2 are the most likely to be associated with genetic mutations. So they are more common, and if you screen these patients, you are more likely to identify gene mutations as compared to patients who have a sigmoid septum or apical hypertrophy. This was a simple algorithm proposed in one of the recent journals. So if you look at the apical 4-chamber view and measure the maximal septal thickness, in the apical 4-chamber view, maximal septal thickness, if it is uniform throughout the view, you call it as a neutral septum. If the maximum septal thickness is confined to the apex, then it is an apical hypertrophy. If the septal thickness is maximum near the base, then it is a sigmoid septum. And if it is maximum towards the mid portion of the septum, bulging into the cavity, that is called a catenoid septum. So is it clear till now? Apart from this, there are other rarer phenotypes like massive septal hypertrophy, where the septal thickness is more than 30 millimeters, midventricular HCM, isolated hypertrophy of the posterior wall, LV apical aneurysms, isolated RV involvement, which is very, very rare, and a restrictive phenotype. A restrictive phenotype of HCM is one in which the hypertrophy is not very marked and they predominantly mimic a restrictive cardiomyopathy. Now, before jumping to a diagnosis of HCM, you must remember that there are other causes of asymmetrical hypertrophy, and the presence of ASH alone does not give you enough diagnostic features to say that this is a hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. So the other causes of ASH are, as I said, hypertensive heart disease, sigmoid septum which is common in the elderly, right ventricular hypertrophy, or prominent RV muscle bands which are present anterior to the IVS. I'll show you a clip in the next slide. Sometimes in LVH, where there is an infarction or thinning of the posterior wall or inferior wall, you may feel that there is asymmetrical hypertrophy. And another very rare cause is a spontaneously closed VST, where the aneurysm tissue or the tricuspid valve bulges into the LVOT. So this is a case of pulmonary stenosis with gross right ventricular hypertrophy. This is what I meant by saying that asymmetrical hypertrophy is not sufficient to make a diagnosis of HCM. If you can look very carefully in this clip, there is a prominent moderator band which is separated very, there is a slight eclusion space there. This is the interventricular septum, this is the moderator band, and there is a gap here. So if you are not careful, you will end up measuring the moderator band along with the IVS and saying that this is a grossly hypertrophic IVS. So here this septal hypertrophy is an indicator of right ventricular hypertrophy and not of LVH. This is an example of the hypertrophy which is seen in a catenoid septum. That is, the septum is bulging into the LV cavity with a maximal thickness in the mid portion of the interventricular septum. So there is diffuse hypertrophy, but predominantly there is a hypertrophy of the septum. You can see the sparkling appearance of the, or the granular texture of the septum, which is bulging into the cavity. This is another patient who had massive hypertrophy of both the septum and the posterior wall. There are other features, so I will be coming to that in the next few slides. So I just want to focus on the pattern of hypertrophy here. This is a septum which is grossly hypertrophied, posterior wall which is also significantly hypertrophied. And look here, even the right ventricle is hypertrophied, the apex, lateral wall. So the whole myocardium is massively hypertrophied. Now if we come to quantitative assessment of LVH, it is difficult to do the LV mass calculation by using conventional formulas in patients with HCM because the hypertrophy is asymmetrical. So the conventional cube formula cannot be used to calculate the LV mass. It will be usually erroneous. So at present, the CMR is the gold standard to calculate the LV mass in these patients. However, there are different semi-quantitative scoring systems. I have not gone into the details of these, but there are scoring systems given by different people to semi-quantitatively assess the degree of LVH. Now, what is the importance of knowing all these septal morphologies? There are some clinical and prognostic indicators. Massive septal hypertrophy where the septum is more than 30 millimeters is a marker for adverse outcomes and sudden death. The left ventricular outflow tract obstruction is most common, like I told you, with catenoid septum and the neutral septum. And catenoid septum is the most common type of morphology and is usually associated with earlier age of presentation, higher incidence of genetic mutations, higher LV mass, more severe diastolic dysfunction, more fibrosis and scarring on the MRI, and higher incidence of sudden death. Before we move on, I'll just a couple of slides on apical hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. This was initially described in Japan, and therefore it's called the Japanese variant. In Japan, it accounts for 20 to 30% of patients with HCM, whereas in the rest of the world, it is only 1 to 2%. So the isolated apical HCM was also described as Yamaguchi syndrome. The diagnostic criteria is the presence of apical hypertrophy with a thickness more than 1.5 centimeters with or without the presence of an apical aneurysm. And this is the characteristic feature. If you look at the LV cavity, it resembles a ace of spades. So it's called a spade-shaped cavity. The characteristic ECG feature of this abnormality is deep and symmetrical T-wave inversions in the precordial leads. Another way to delineate this ace of spades cavity is using a LV contrast echocardiography, where the contrast bubbles will fill the cavity and you get the typical spade-shaped appearance. The same can be demonstrated even on MRI clips. Thanks to Dr. Vivek for giving me this. So this is the massively hypertrophied LV apex, and you can see somewhat a spade-shaped appearance of the LV cavity. So MRI is also equally good in assessing the septal hypertrophy morphology. Now coming on to the echo assessment proper of HCM, it started with M-mode, so I will also start with M-mode. The classical features of M-mode echocardiography are presence of asymmetrical hypertrophy. Like I told you earlier, it has to be taken in at multiple levels. preferably the short axis view, because there can be tangential errors. In the PLAX view, if the cursor is not perpendicular to the ventricular myocardium, you may end up either measuring more or less. So you may not get the correct value. So that is why a proper short axis view at multiple levels is what is recommended to measure the ventricular thickness. The LV cavity size is either normal or reduced. The left atrium is dilated, and this is a prognostic marker. There is systolic anterior motion of the mitral valve, and there is a, what is seen in this view, this clip is mid-systolic notch in the aortic valve. So I'll come to these mechanisms shortly. First, we'll start with SAM. So SAM, or systolic anterior motion of the mitral valve, was first described in 1969 by Shah et al. It occurs in about 1/3 to 2/3 of patients with HCM, and most of these patients, at least half of these patients, will demonstrate LVOT obstruction. So SAM is also a marker of LVOT obstruction, and it is also directly responsible for the mitral regurgitation which occurs in these patients. Now, what are the mechanisms of this SAM? There are certain predisposing factors. Earlier it was thought that SAM is caused predominantly by the ventricular forces, but now it is known that there is a significant contribution of the mitral valve anatomy also, which is responsible for development of SAM. So what are the predisposing factors? There is hypertrophy of the basal septum, there is anterior displacement of the papillary muscles, and there is elongation of the mitral leaflets. So in the setting of these factors, when the left ventricle contracts forcefully, the hydrodynamic force almost sweeps the mitral leaflets towards the septum. So the mitral leaflets are almost pushed anteriorly and made to hit the interventricular septum. This is currently believed to be the predominant mechanism for development of SAM. So it is vigorous contraction of the posterior wall, abnormally placed papillary muscles and elongated AML, and narrowed and asymmetrical hypertrophy. So when the ventricle contracts, it sweeps the mitral valve and makes it hit the septum. Now, the earlier effect, which was called as Venturi effect or suction effect of the mitral valve, is believed to play only a minor role, and probably it plays a role during mid or late systole, but it does not initiate the systolic anterior motion. Ma'am? I think I'll finish on time. So the Venturi effect is believed to be playing a minor role, and it takes over probably towards the later part of systole. SAM usually begins with the onset of isovolumetric systole, and as the mitral leaflets start closing in towards the septum, there is a pressure gradient which develops across the leaflets. There is high pressure in the cavity and low pressure in the LVOT, which further pushes the leaflets and makes them stick onto the septum. So there is a prolongation of the anterior movement and it touches the septum. So this is what is called as obstruction begets obstruction. So once it starts, it is like a continuous cycle where the septum, the mitral valve is not allowed to come away from the septum. We must be aware of certain other causes of SAM. I won't go into all the details, but SAM can also occur in elderly with a sigmoid septum. It can occur in acute coronary syndromes, hypovolemia, and in Thakkar-Sutter syndrome. Now, there was an entity called pseudo-SAM. Pseudo-SAM is a normal phenomenon which occurs in normal people, where a vigorous contraction of the posterior wall can move the mitral leaflets anteriorly. But in pseudo-SAM, the peak of the SAM will coincide with the peak of posterior wall contraction, whereas in true SAM, the peak of SAM will precede the posterior wall contraction. And usually mitral regurgitation and LVOT obstruction are not features of pseudo-SAM. SAM has been graded by Gilbert et al. In 1980. If there is a SAM, if there is a distance of more than 10 millimeters, minimum distance between the mitral valve and the septum, if it's more than 10 millimeters, it's mild SAM. If it is less than 10 millimeters, or if the septum comes in contact for less than 30% of systole, it is moderate. And if in this particular case, if the septum is almost, the leaflets are touching the septum for most part of systole, it is a severe SAM. Again, just a few video clips. So if you concentrate on this is the same echo which I showed earlier. I just want you to concentrate on the mitral leaflets and see how they are moving anteriorly and touching the septum. It's very well seen in this view, where the leaflets are bending forward and touching the septum. So this is because of the hydrodynamic effect which pushes the leaflet anteriorly. Another way to demonstrate SAM is 3D echocardiography. The left panel shows a normal normal 3D echo as viewed from the mitral apex. You are able to clearly see the aortic valve, and this is the mitral valve and LVOT. When there is SAM, the anterior mitral leaflet will come and close the LVOT. So you are not able to see the aortic valve through the apex. If you are visualizing, you will not be able to see the aortic valve. Okay. Again, MRI can also demonstrate SAM very well. Look at the leaflets here and see how the leaflets are moving towards the bulged septum. Sorry, I think it stopped playing. Okay, we'll move on. Now coming on to presence or absence of LVOT obstruction. Now, the truly non-obstructive HCM accounts only for 1/3 of patients. So 30% will not have any form of obstruction. The remaining 70%, 30% will have resting LVOT obstruction, which can be seen on resting echo. And another 40% will have what is called as latent obstruction, where there is a provocable obstruction. So there are different maneuvers to provoke the gradients. A significant resting gradient is defined as a peak gradient of more than 30 millimeters, and a provocable gradient is more than 50 millimeters. So this can be identified on continuous wave Doppler. As you can see, the pattern of the CW trace is typical of a dagger shaped appearance, as opposed to the parabolic or ellipsoid shape which you see in a fixed obstruction. So this dagger shaped obstruction trace indicates a dynamic LVOT obstruction. You should be careful not to confuse this with a mitral regurgitation jet. Usually the MR jet will be more oval in shape, and the MR jet will have a longer period. So it occupies more part of the systole as compared. Even the MR in HCM may not be truly pan-systolic MR, but it tends to occupy more of the systole as compared to the LVOT trace. So this is the same patient, okay, the same patient where I have taken the LVOT gradient. Here you are getting a gradient of 62. This is the dagger shaped tracing. By slightly altering the direction of the beam, I am getting 126. Okay, so it is very easy to mix up the MR jet and end up overestimating the LVOT obstruction if your beam is not truly aligned. So some people recommend that you go to the apical three chamber view, where you completely eliminate the mitral regurgitation and measure only the LVOT obstruction. So that is one way of eliminating MR. The other thing is MR is dagger shaped, and third, you will get very high velocities. So if you get velocities more than 5 meter per second, suspect that your jet is contaminated with mitral regurgitation. The lobster claw anomaly or abnormality was described and refers to a mid-systolic drop in the left ventricular ejection. So during ejection, there is a drop in the velocity, and this indicates a true obstructive cardiomyopathy. So this can occur with LVOT obstruction or mid-cavity obstruction. This correlates with the mid-systolic closure of the aortic valve. So the mechanism of closure of the aortic valve is a mid-systolic drop in the ejection velocity. So what is the lobster claw abnormality? If you can see this picture here, the claw of the lobster, and look at the tracing here. So there is a drop in the velocity which occurs during mid part of systole, which is due to true obstruction occurring within the LV. Now, what are the provocative tests which can be done for LVOT obstruction? Standing is an easy test. So you can repeat the echo with the patient standing. You can ask the patient to strain and measure during the Valsalva maneuver. Postprandial, 30 minutes after a meal, you can measure the gradients. Use of nitrates, these are the standard tests. We do not recommend use of dobutamin or isoproterenol. And then coming to exercise stress echocardiography. So if you are not able to provoke gradients using any of these maneuvers, you can go for exercise stress echocardiography. The role of exercise stress echo is provocation of gradients, to check for worsening MR, to check for systolic or diastolic dysfunction, wall motion abnormalities, exercise tolerance, and in risk stratification. So this is what happens with exercise. There will be increase in the gradients and worsening of mitral regurgitation. Now, new data suggests that exercise stress echocardiography is a marker of disease progression. Patients who have a positive stress echo, that is where there is a provocable gradient, these patients are more likely to go into NYHA class 3 or 4 symptoms within 1 year, as compared to those who do not have a provocable gradient. So based on this, there are algorithms. The basic summary of this algorithm is, patients who have class 3 or 4 symptoms but do not have provocable gradients are candidates for transplant, whereas those who do have provocable gradients are candidates for septal myectomy. Coming on to the assessment of the mitral valve, so this is probably the most important parameter to be assessed in patients with HCM. There are many abnormalities of the mitral valve, which I'll show in the next slide. The most common what we find is mitral regurgitation, which is, like I described, it is directly proportional to the extent of SAM and severity of SAM. It is a posteriorly directed jet, starts after systole and progresses to the mid or late systole. So this is what is described as the seagull sign of HCM. There is diversion of the color jet. As the jet leaves the LVOT, the color jet will diverge. One jet goes into the left atrium in the form of MR and the other jet goes into the LVOT. So this is the typical MR of HCM. You see, as there is SAM, the LVOT obstruction begins and the mitral valve starts to leak. So since the two leaflets will separate more anteriorly, the MR jet comes posteriorly and laterally. So there is a posterolateral mitral regurgitation, which indicates that the MR is probably due to the SAM and the LVOT obstruction. So this type of mitral regurgitation responds very well to septal myectomy or alcohol septal ablation, because the mechanism is predominantly due to the SAM and the elongation of the anterior mitral leaflet. Now there are different other abnormalities of the mitral valve. For want of time, I will just skip this slide. And based on the different abnormalities, we can decide what type of surgery is to be done for the mitral valve. Normally, the resection of the septum is what is recommended. But if the mitral valve is elongated or if there are abnormal papillary muscles, you need to plicate the mitral valve. So plicate refers to AML plication and, sorry, this should be release. Resect, plicate and release. So release refers to release of the papillary muscle. So this is called as the RPR surgery for HCM. Resect the septum, plicate the anterior mitral leaflet and release the anterior papillary muscle. Now this is another patient which we had with HCM. It looks like a regular case of HCM. But if you see, look carefully, there is a prolapse of the PML. If you are able to see on 2D, initially we were not able to really identify, we thought it is SAM. But you, if you can see, the PML is prolapsing into the LV. Look at the direction of the MR jet. It is going anteriorly. So this is an anteromedially directed jet. This should lead you to suspect that this is an MR which is not due to SAM. It is an MR which is due to abnormality of the mitral leaflet. So a central MR or an anteriorly directed jet is indicative of a mitral valve abnormality. Now LV systolic function is usually preserved in HCM, except for 5 to 10% who go on to develop a burnt out disease which mimics a dilated cardiomyopathy. And this is more common in patients who have a myofilament mutations. If there is systolic dysfunction, it becomes imperative to rule out associated coronary artery disease and silent infarction. Diastolic dysfunction is almost universal. So the most I will not detail all the features of diastolic dysfunction because that will be coming up in the next talk. But the most important thing which we need to do in HCM is to look at the tissue doppler velocities of the mitral annulus. So there will be a decreased systolic velocity and decrease in the E' velocity. Tissue Doppler is useful even in detecting preclinical stages of hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. This is one of our patients who was a post-op case of HCM. Following Morrow's procedure, that is septal resection, probably too much of the septum had been resected. He ended up with scarring, LV dysfunction, aortic regurgitation, and ended up as a dilated cardiomyopathy. So this is one of the worst case scenarios in HCM. We had to schedule him for a cardiac transplant, but unfortunately he succumbed before that. The involvement of the right ventricle in HCM is common in 15 to 30% of cases and usually associated with LV involvement. If there is RVOT obstruction, you must consider Noonan syndrome, because this is one condition where you get RVOT obstruction with HCM. This is a patient, again one of the same patient which I showed the earlier slides, where there is a dynamic RVOT obstruction. You can see the hypertrophy of the RV, which is compressing on the RVOT. So to summarize the echo features, what are the markers which suggest adverse prognosis in these patients? Presence of massive septal hypertrophy, apical aneurysms, severe LVOT obstruction, severe MR, increased LA diameter or volume, severe diastolic dysfunction, that is if the tissue Doppler velocities are on the lateral annulus are less than 4 cm per second, decrease in global longitudinal strain and progressive wall thinning. Now when we come to screening of family members, it is rarely indicated in the age group of less than 12 years. So children, we do not recommend screening unless there is a malignant family history of sudden cardiac death or premature death, or if the child is engaging in any kind of competitive sports. So these are the indications where we would like to screen the children. Once they attain the age of 12 years, from 12 to 21 years, we screen them on an annual basis, around 12 to 18 months. You have to screen them because this is the time when the disease usually develops. Beyond adulthood, like after 21 years, if nothing has happened, there has been no progression, then you can screen them every 5 years and probably 2 to 5 years in patients where you suspect that there is a strong family history or a malignant family history. So this, with this I complete the description of the echo assessment of HCM. I'll just like to show, if I have time, I'll just like to show a few of the differential diagnosis. The chairperson. So can I go ahead with the, just a few, because I just want to know, to tell you what should not be confused with HCM. The athlete's heart is the most commonly asked question as to why, how you differentiate an athlete's heart from HCM. The athlete's heart develops in patients who have undergone rigorous cardiovascular training. The features of the athlete's heart are the LV cavity size is normal, whereas in HCM it is decreased. You don't get SAM, you don't get LVOT obstruction, and the diastolic parameters are normal. That is, you have a normal systolic velocity on tissue Doppler and normal E prime velocity. So if tissue Doppler is very useful in distinguishing the athlete's heart from HCM. And the septal thickness is usually never very high. So it is usually less than 13 millimeters in athlete's heart and more than 16 in HCM. And between 13 and 16 is considered as a gray zone. So can anyone tell me which is athlete's heart and which is HCM? On the left side and the right side. This one is athlete's heart. Okay, there is a normal diastolic function. You look at the E prime. Okay, it is normal. Whereas here you have decreased E prime velocity, decreased systolic velocity. Now another differential diagnosis is discrete subaortic stenosis. So discrete subaortic stenosis is a fixed obstruction where there is a visible membrane. Many times in adults you may not see the membrane, you have to search for it or you have to send them for transesophageal echo. Here you are seeing a membrane in the LVOT. Again there is subaortic stenosis, but it is a fixed obstruction and most of these patients will have associated aortic regurgitation. So that's one way to differentiate. And if you see the CW tracing, it resembles aortic stenosis. It is not a dagger shaped tracing. This is an interesting case which we had where there is a massive hypertrophy in the mid portion of the septum, wherein we thought actually that this is some kind of a tumor of the interventricular septum. Unfortunately, we still don't have tissue diagnosis for this patient. It could still be a very atypical form of HCM. We did an MRI. As you can see the clips here, there is massive hypertrophy of the septum. Okay, that's not playing again. Which is causing RVOT obstruction. So you can see the narrowing of the RVOT here because of the septal bulge. Yeah, I'm done, sir. Just two more slides, sorry. Cardiac amyloid will be discussed in the subsequent talks, but you can see the sparkling appearance of the myocardium mimics an HCM. The features which tell you that this is unlikely to be HCM are presence of pericardial effusion and absence of systolic motion, and there is no LVOT obstruction. Thickening of the interatrial septum is a classically described feature in amyloid. And this is a differential diagnosis for apical HCM. So wherein if you have hypereosinophilic syndrome or sometimes an LV clot, these features can be confused for a apical cardiomyopathy. So to summarize, this is the very last slide. So the different role of echocardiography and different modalities in assessing the hypertrophic cardiomyopathy throughout the natural history. So from starting to establish a diagnosis, look for LVOT obstruction, assess the mitral valve, look for apical involvement, assess the LV function, then echo does have an important role in guiding the surgeon for adequacy of septal dissection, and also in guiding intervention, if you are doing an alcohol septal ablation to identify whether you are in the correct septal artery, echo has a role in that, and also in screening. So to conclude, echocardiography is an invaluable tool. You need to do a meticulous assessment. Avoid over-enthusiastic diagnosis. Just because you are not able to explain anything, don't label it as non-obstructive hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. This leads to unnecessary anxiety for the patient, the family members. They bring all the family members for screening. So this is probably the most important take-home message. Don't be over-enthusiastic to diagnose. And CMR is the current gold standard for diagnosis of HCM. Thank you very much.